Sorry. Sorry.
You need to come up here because it's getting video, Murray.
Some of the things that struck me as particularly interesting and relevant. Perhaps I'd just say a couple of things. One of the things that struck me about Jill was it made me think of Barbie, because Barbie has a curious history. I don't know if you're aware of it, but Barbie actually has her origins in a German sex doll called Lily. And Mattel ripped off this sex doll, which it was a kind of novelty doll, and turned her into Barbie. Whereas with Jill, it's almost going from the normal baby doll kind of thing to an abject figure, so it's kind of going the opposite. So it just struck me as interesting that Jill had kind of taken that trajectory. It also the whole issue of the making non-disabled gays visible, also it put me in mind of a film which, whilst not particularly emotionally rewarding, is, I think, a really thought-provoking film, is Lars von Trier's film The Idiots, in which a group of young middle-class people go around spazzing, as they call it, taking turns to pretend to have an intellectual disability or to be a carer, and go around trying to kind of con members of the public and expose their bourgeois mentality. But it's quite an interesting kind of look at the way in which non-disabled people try to appropriate and practice this sort of disabled identity. In relation to invisible impairment, that was particularly interesting to me, because I do have invisible impairment. What's wrong with Murray? Have your guesses. Your comment reminded me of there's a BBC podcast called Ouch, and they had, or maybe still have, a phone-in game where somebody phones in, and in the studio, through a series of yes-no questions, they have to guess what the person's impairment is.
Yeah.
It's
fun.
And what I find personally is that invisible impairment isn't an issue until it's an issue. You know, and so that decision about what to say, what to do, you're always kind of thinking about, well, what might happen at some point, rather than what is here and now. You know, so if you don't declare it, and then it becomes an issue, then it's just very kind of complicated and messy. One of the things that for me connected all three papers was that it all made me kind of question the extent to which you seem to be kind of shifting the focus, right? But I think away from how are people accommodated, what is reasonable adjustment towards, and what are people being accommodated into, and why should they be accommodated into that, and let's not take that thing for granted, that in a social and cultural and economic space. I'm not asking any questions, just kind of throwing all these things out, but I wonder if any of you had any thoughts that you wanted to respond to on those.
One of the things that I think the interesting thing is with all three papers is, you know, disability is not a pretty subject. It's actually some quite complex and sometimes nasty battles, power struggles, you know, over acceptance and celebration of difference, you know, versus in, you know, you will fit in or else. And the parking one is really interesting because, well may I laugh, and it's very close to my heart, that picture, I think. There's been some really interesting battles because, you know, disability parking's about premium space, it's about burdens, it's about budgets. You know, there's been debates about whether women in their final trimester of their pregnancy, for example, can use disability parking. There's been issues about whether should people get privileged parking outside stadiums. So I think all this is interesting because it raises issues about not just disability, but how social space is used, and then how we might, and I know Razak talks about this, she's a Canadian scholar, Cherie Razak, talks about the creation of anomalous zones. It's kind of like how we manage it. You know, I think she was a feminist scholar that was talking about, well, how you regulate prostitution is by setting up red light districts. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think... that whole spatial stuff with the dance and the arts would be dance, my accent here. with dance and also theatre and stuff to kind of really unpack that kind of use of space. And, because even with the train, the bus thing, you know, in many ways those people were entering prohibited space, but then there's the space of, shall we touch them? What will it feel like? Do we arrest them? And then I was thinking about that because then what happens if you arrest those cripples? Then we've got to find accessible jails, which, by the way, in the United States they are now building jails for physically disabled people. But so there's a whole lot of issues about space and touch.
Yeah.
So I didn't ask a question.
No, I'm thinking about how obvious it is that the three papers that we talked about today all has to do with this managing difference and sameness, and how it's an area that is quite, explosive almost, that because if you say that sameness is something good or difference is something good, especially when you talk about disability in work, or if you start to critical examine what do we mean by accommodation, it's like undermining something that for years has been the tool to kind of in a political struggle to get disabled people to take place in the labour market. But I think we still have to deal with this sameness difference and question who the ideal worker is, and I can recognize a lot of that when you talk.
And I think it's quite interesting that in feminist research there is critical masculinity studies, in race and ethnicity research, there is whiteness studies, and so on. There is a quite long tradition of studying heteronormativity and the middle class, and so on. But this studies in ableism, this is so new within the disability research in Sweden. It's I think you can count them on one or two hands, the researchers that are interested in studying the
Thoughts on the on ideas around hypernormality and the ways in which sometimes the notion of normality moving away from simply a notion of the average in a sense towards hyper identities again. Thinking of a film, American Mary, Jen and Sylvia Soska, in which the central character becomes this kind of underground plastic subject. And there's one of the characters, Ruby Real Girl, comes along and she wants to be like Barbie. Now, what that means for her is quite literal. She wants a nipple removed. She wants as much of her genitalia removed as absolutely possible. You know, so she takes this kind of notion of Barbie as an ideal and actually tries to make it as real as possible. Do you see any evidence of these kind of hyper identities emerging, and are they influencing disability studies?
We don't know about them influencing disability studies, but I mean, in fact, I only read last week about an individual who's had about 67 surgeries and actually wants to be constructed as totally non-gendered. So any anatomical inference that demarcates sex or gender, depending on how you view it, is being removed, and there's a whole lot of discussions around health. But I think the fact is that hyper-endowed, it happens already now, and I think that's where there's some synergies between cosmetic surgery and cosmetic neurology, this emulation towards what people envisage as the norm. But I think the norm's not static, because in fact, then we're now talking about the fact that in the future, actually being so-called species typical, which I would say is the current human, is actually boring. You want to have, it's people with value added. You know, I've got a diagram from Germany that totally maps different body parts and talks about the fact that in 2 or 3 years the warranty will run out, and can you take it back and get this bit refixed? And lots of money is getting put into these kinds of projects. The irony is this is happening, however, at the same time, and I think for me it's a sign of a crisis happening within particularly Western modernity, because at the same time then you've got the majority world dealing with kind of war and maiming and skeletal bodies. So far away from the perceived concept of norm. But the other thing is anthropologists have showed us anyway is that the normal body is a cultural body. I mean, there is no such thing as kind of a pure concept of the human species typical functioning, because, you know, in some societies where people are running and walking or doing different things with their bodies are shaped differently.
Yeah.
So that's a myth too, that somehow we've got this kind of this anatomically correct species typical body. Mm. Which, if it is out there, it's definitely a Western, particular Western privileged view.
I don't know, I associate more to the hyper-normality, you called it, to what some of my informants said, that how they, it seems like they tried to live up to this productivity, and how they managed that by taking all the medication and being tired in the weekend, so they could deal with the work in the weekdays, or having their partner do all of the housework in order to be this or live up to this, as I see it, hypernormality in terms of the worker, like being productive, and maybe that's some kind of similarities between this trying. Not what you look like, but what you actually produce. Or
No, I don't think so. Maybe in my thesis I wrote about this young woman who were doing sports, and there you have the super pimps, but they can never be as good as the, you know, one informant said, we had an athletic star who won gold medals, Carolina Klift, you probably don't know her, but she won gold medals in the Olympic Games and so on, and they said, some of my interviewees, they won gold medals in Paralympics, but they couldn't have her, Carolina Klift, as a role model, because she was in another league. even if they put so much effort and time into sport, they couldn't compare with her.
I don't know if you're aware of this. In the UK, we started with the London Olympics, well, the Paralympics, which were being covered by Channel 4 in this country, and their slogan was
super,
kind of feeds into that.
But they're
either more than people or they're less than people.
But it's interesting that issue of disability sports and we've done is it also can be quite subversive and dangerous, because I can remember, another researcher's done work on this, that, you know, you had a bunch of young people with acquired impairments and they were being interviewed by journalists. And they started saying things like, oh yeah, disability was the best thing that happened to me. If I hadn't have had, you know, had my accident or whatever, I would have been, you know, in this sheltered, boring country town, and now I'm meeting different people, now I'm travelling the world, and I got into sport. And, you know, so there was this kind of almost aspirational discourse that, you know, that was really dangerous. So kind of like, you know, dear mummy, when I grow up, can I become a wheelchair user like this person? And what they found was that once that was cottoned onto, that media were actually shutting down that discourse, because again, it didn't fit into that kind of thing. So there is a kind of an interesting sort of subversive element, and certainly, I mean, one of the things in sports, not my area, it'd be interesting to see now, we've almost got this saturation of the Paralympics where, you know, you do get young people saying, oh gee, I really like to do that or do this and be like them, and then parents don't know what to say.
Kind of hogging it up here. Does anybody have any questions they want to ask the whole panel?
If my voice carries wrong on this, but two things. One is just a comment in terms of the sport and Paralympics. I found fascinating watching the Oscar Pistorius trial and the sort of dichotomy between, was he seen as normal or was he seen as disabled, and people's reaction then to whether or not he was actually guilty of what he'd done. The question I'd like to ask, though, is you're involved in teaching students. Some of what, Elspeth, you spoke about was almost radical approaches. Do you translate that into your teaching, or do your colleagues translate any of that into their teaching?
Can you pose the question again?
How you translate the work or the research you've done into your teaching, and I'm particularly interested, given some of the things that you were talking about, which is almost a radical approach, do you engage students in actually thinking in that way?
We read Fiona's texts together, and then they asked me, but what can you study if you want to do studies in ableism? And then I said, yes, you can begin with the buildings at Malmö University, because we have this really problematic situation there. And they think it's really interesting, because we have been discussing the medical model and the social model, and then they think, oh, the social model and disability studies, they are the good ones. And then they think, oh, we have to think one step further on. and shift the perspective once more. And they think it's very interesting. And I think it's very, very inspiring with this.
I mean, I think from my point of view, I think hearing that stuff, I kind of do work around leadership, social workers as leaders in practice, and they continually struggle with why you teach me leadership, I want to be a social worker. And those ideas noted down the kind of guild work, because that's what I want them to think about, is where leadership happens, how it happens. And when people get inspired to think about change, where it comes from, how it happens, and how challenging that can be, and how difficult and dangerous that can be for people. But actually, so I will certainly use that, those examples in my teaching. I'll contact you about maybe exploring that a bit further, because I think that that has the opportunity to really start to chip away at those notions of leadership and what is it about.
I think the other thing is, you know, I mean, as someone who's ostensibly a social theorist, you know, when you're teaching, sometimes students, and in fact even other academics, will question the relevance of social theory to practice. For me, you know, one of the things about critical disability studies and studies in ableism is it generates different questions that we should ask and reflect upon, including, you know, questions about discomfort. And, you know, I mean, I don't want to end my comments on a salacious note, but I'll use this as an example. I mean, in terms of discomfort, and I could imagine it coming up with health workers or social workers indeed, is the phenomenon of known as trans-ableism, which is a group of people who are really emerging within society now. They've been around for a long time, but in terms of really gathering a voice in YouTube videos as well as text, and they're people who fairly similar to gender dysphoria, are people who believe that they are incomplete because they're able-bodied, so they either want an amputation or want some sort of paralysis or some sort of blindness. Now, I know that myself, when I was doing some research in that area, I mean, I think some academics frankly thought that I was morally bankrupt for doing this kind of research. And you know, and there's been some really interesting reactions from the disability studies community. But so when I'd be working with students like this, you know, because these people actually are probably more prevalent than people were aware of, is to say, well, you know, to look at the questions. We're really talking about endowment here and enhancement. And, you know, we don't sit there and say, well, you know, and necessarily get squirmish if somebody wants a boob job or wants to, you know, extend the length of their penis or whatever, or to, as they do in Korea, break their legs and then reset them to make them longer. I mean, there's all sorts of really interesting questions and issues there, because some of those things are culturally seen as contributions towards beauty, and that's not necessarily pathologised. I must say, often the naughty party would say, why not? But then we start looking at the kind of issue of people who say, well, look, you know, I feel incomplete because I'm able-bodied. I would be my true self, in inverted commas, if I had an impairment. Suddenly we start problematising that, having the disgusting yuck factor. Now, I guess the issue for me, from a teaching thing, is these theories teach us that there's no such thing as black and white. There's shifts, there's changes, there's ambivalence. But for students to get in touch with their discomfort and, I guess, kind of develop conceptual systems to negotiate that discomfort.
Mm-hmm. May I say one thing? I think on our department, we do both have the education in social work and this social pedagogical work in the field of disabilities. We have a bit different student groups because we have a lot of students. We have a more diverse group. We have students with experiences of racism. We have working class students. We have a lot of students with different disabilities. So they know this, they have emotional experiences of meeting racist, ableist, etc. So I think it's more easy to teach them. The bigger department of social work, they have a research group, which is called the research groups, group of exposed groups or something.
Mm.
And within disability studies, it's impossible to say that we are studying exposed groups,
mm-hmm.
because we are several colleagues with different kinds of impairments and
more vulnerable groups.
Yes, vulnerable groups, and that they don't feel. I think it's easier to talk with students about these things when you have these experiences in the classroom.
Well,
sorry.
Go. I just wanted to make a kind of observation on something we've already touched on in Elizabeth's paper, but link it also to something Fiona had in her paper. If we go back to the occupation of the West Tragic bus, what happened there is incredibly powerful and has a lot of scope. Because there you see a situation where the police want to make an intervention, but they're frightened of the consequences of it. And I've seen this, I can think of a couple of scenarios with disrupted flights involving people with disabilities. One case, it was a school party of 12 children in wheelchairs. And in that instance, the airline went beyond the call of duty of major disruption to still operate the flight once the weather improved sufficiently. Tabled opening or keeping any port open after its official closing time, expensive operation. They were really worried about backlash that could appear in the press by these children being stranded because of circumstances that were not of their making, but they were very sensitive to that. It wasn't United Airlines in my head. that can be very, very powerful, but there are still challenges in how that power is translated to other situations, and this is where we got into the political thing. We don't want another referendum, but here we are in an unwanted general election, so it's here. So you have a situation where I know a lot of people with very enhanced, if that's the word, impairments who are very worried about possibility of voluntary euthanasia type legislation coming in, so you get availability of a dignitas type of operation in this country, so that you're unable to travel because you want to pursue that. They see a lot of dangers in that and they're very much against it. And so far governments have resisted in this country making that available. But isn't it ironic at the same time you've got a government who's now campaigning for re-election, and what they're doing to people with various needs for support, living allowances and so forth have been driven, now well documented, on a massive scale to taking their own lives. They're so desperate. Yet the small number that might be affected by legislation for voluntary euthanasia, that's a no-go area. So I think what I'm saying here is that you get a kind of irony there, that that's a battle that still has to be fought, and a way of finding how it can be fought is still to be effectively discovered. So that the heartlessness of recent government policies, which I'll continue, it can be challenged.
I think that's where, when I talk about the definition of ableism as a set of causal conditions, is that you can have that same scenario with the transport thing, but depending on what else is playing at the time, the effect of it can be quite different, you know, and different senses of dangerousness. So, for example, unlike Sweden, I know in Australia, you know, disabled people have actually, you know, got onto the public transport. They've chains, locked themselves in trams and trains and stuff. And then that reaction about what to do, that's been resolved now. I mean, they get dragged out. And in fact, now then the press comes in and says, well, you know, we gave you special rights, you're greedy. So the backlash kind of thing. And this is about the conditions of change that kind of come into play here. And I think that's why we do need some theoretical work, because we might say, well, why did change happen at this time and in this place? But then the same thing was enacted and, you know, maybe it backfired or something else happened.
Mm-hmm. We also had a case earlier this year or last year where the court ruled on the issue of wheelchair versus pushchair on the bus, and
last year
had
priority,
and ruled in favour of wheelchair users. But it was kind of meaningless, because you know, who's going to enforce that? The bus driver? Bus drivers aren't going to start throwing people from the bus, doesn't matter whether it's a pushchair or a wheelchair user. Despite the court ruling, that remains a real kind of issue. Okay, I should probably wrap up there after what has been a really, really fascinating day. Thank you all for coming. Thanks to our speakers who have been really, really interesting. It's been fantastic to have you along. I should also thank Susan, who's been the coordinator for the Swedish guests and whilst they've been here, and Jim McDonald, who's been doing background administration to the event. Most of all to Fiona, who got this thing off the ground. As Susan said at the start, hopefully this will be the first of a regular series of seminars in the school as we try to establish ourselves as a key centre for disability studies. So if you haven't already given us your details, and I guess you must, there's a sheet there, there's also leaflets and limited copies of Fiona's paper. I don't know if we have access to you.
We don't currently, but if we get your email address, we can send the PowerPoints out.
Yeah. That'll be okay?
Yeah.
Right, fantastic. Okay, well then, in that case, sorry.
Thank you for insightful wrapping up.
Thanks very much for coming along. The rain appears to have gone off, so hopefully
we'll
stay on.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.